Welcome, everybody, to the Tiger Network for Game 2 of Trinity University versus Southwestern University. It's the Tigers versus the Pirates as the first pitch makes it so we're underway. Strike one, as on the mound for the Tigers is Luke Pfeiffer, going up against Jake Harris in the leadoff spot yet again. I'm Reed Rosales, joined by Luke Terry. And Luke, tell us a bit about Luke Pfeiffer.
Yeah, well, I mean, we talked about it on the air a little bit last night. These are two teams that have been plagued by some injuries in their pitching staffs. And, of course, Pfeiffer coming in, a junior out of Valencia, California, has plenty of experience here in San Antonio, but wasn't particularly someone slotted into this weekend rotation starting role at the outset of this year. But he's come in. You know, he got a start weekend one against Babson, so he's started every opportunity he's had this season. And while he's struggled in some spots, I think he's filled the role very nicely, all things considered.
That pitch low and away will be a ball. Full count for the leadoff Pirate, Jake Harris. Harris started game one with a single. Can you do it against Pfeiffer? Weak contact, taken in by the third baseman. The spin and throw gets him at first base. A great throw by Kai Tinker over at third. A little spin around throw to get the first out of the inning.
Yeah, kind of an awkward one right there. It looked like perhaps Harris was significantly out in front of this one and took a little bit of an awkward bounce off the end of his bat, maybe a little bit of weird spin as it was making its way over to Kai Tinker at third base. But we've already talked about him in this series, very sure-handed defensively, and he needed it right there as he went with a bare hand pickup and still was able to get off the leadoff man.
It's a swing and a miss for Christian Melillo. One out in the top of the first. The left fielder swings through that one so quickly in a hole. 0-2. Pfeiffer trying to set a good tone for the day. Tigers taking game one by a score of 5-2. Contact made, but foul. Product out of Lutheran South Academy. Working with a 1-2 count. Swings through that one. But made contact, so still a 1-2 count.
And Pfeiffer doing a nice job right now of just operating ahead in this count, just trying to stay in this position.
That one misses outside. 2-2 count for Melillo. That one misses the zone. So a full count for Christian Melillo. His patience is currently being rewarded. Contact made, but more of a stay-alive swing, it seems. Still a full count.
Yeah, three really nice offerings from Pfeiffer right there. Even the two that Melillo was able to hold off on and take outside to fourth count full, I felt like they were still competitive pitches right outside the zone.
Swing and a miss. Luke Pfeiffer collects strikeout number one of the day as Christian Melillo will head back to the dugout. We head over to James Vaquero in the three-hole spot again for Southwestern. Junior out of Houston, Texas. Swings through that one for strike one. Luke Pfeiffer trying to sit down the Pirates, 1-2-3 in the top of the first. But he'll hit James Vaquero on the back of the leg. It'll be a free base for Vaquero. So runner on first now for the cleanup hitter, Jacob Tanner. He takes a practice swing before stepping into the box.
And ultimately, not a whole lot of harm done right there. Good job from Pfeiffer in this start, getting the first two outs of the inning. Don't want to see it continue by putting a runner on because of a hit by pitch, but still an opportunity to get out of things unscathed here to start his day in San Antonio.
1-0 pitch from Pfeiffer. That one is spiked. Vaquero stays at first. Lazara able to keep it in front of him. Two-0 pitch misses for ball three. So a 3-0 count for the cleanup hitter, Jacob Tanner, working with Vaquero on first. And strike one. Tanner was most likely given a red light. It's a 3-1 count. Too high. So two free bases for the Pirates. Puts a runner in scoring position for the ever-present and ever-dangerous Maxwell Mims.
Yeah, and that bat, a little bit more concerning for Luke Pfeiffer to start off this first inning. Understand that there's going to be some throws, some pitches that get away from you every now and then, and especially with two outs on the board, a guy like James Vaquero is a three-hole hitter up to the plate. I don't think you mind too much by putting him on with a hit-by-pitch. But ultimately, turning around, falling behind in a 3-0 count, warrants a conversation here with pitching coach Dave Smith, who very likely will just come out and have this conversation much too early in this one to warrant a change, especially as we talked about it, a pin and a staff that has faced some issues with injury and maybe still trying to work through some things, sort out which guys will come in which scenarios. But I know that they'll need more from Luke Pfeiffer today. And I think that's probably the one thing that he's going to work towards more than anything else, is being able to give this squad some more distance in his starts. So far this year, he's gone 4 1/3, 1 2/3, and 3 2/3 in his most recent start against Centenary.
The first pitch to Maxwell Mims. Strike one on the outside corner.
Yeah, certainly more competitive than a lot of the pitches in the last at-bat, but still definitely gets the benefit of a call right there from the home plate umpire.
The 0-1 pitch. Swings to that one, makes contact. It'll be a foul tip into the glove for strike two.
Yeah, and that first offering definitely playing an influence on Maxwell Mims, who's forced to pick up his hands the next time out.
That one is fouled back into the foul netting. Still an 0-2 count. Wind blowing, but not necessarily blowing in like it was yesterday. Saw Mims hit one pretty hard, but the wind kind of keeping it in the ballpark. That one misses for ball one. Tiger pitching will have to be a bit more precarious with Mims today. Ground ball over to the shortstop. Throw over to first. Will be in time. Jack Baker retires Maxwell Mims with his throw over to Christian Holloway at first. And that'll be the end of the top of the first inning. James Vaquero and Jacob Tanner stranded on the base paths. We head to the bottom of the frame here on the Tiger Network. Welcome back to the Tiger Network. You can see the starting lineup for the Tigers on your screen. It is Pierce Matthews, followed by Kai Tinker, Nicholas Lazara, Christian Holloway, Colt Harris, Cal Coney, Jack Peterson, Jack Baker, and Maddox McDonald to round things out for the starting lineup for the Trinity University Tigers. Meanwhile, on the mound for the Pirates of Southwestern, it is Stephen Rutherford. Rutherford, a senior, trying to hold down the Tigers here in this second game with his sidearm delivery.
Yeah, and a lot of changes in this Trinity offense because of the lefty on the mound. But in games that I've called here on Tiger Network this season, the lefties that this lineup has seen, I'm not sure how many of them have dropped down to more of this sidearm delivery.
So a quick 1-1 count to Pierce Matthews from out of Carrollton, Texas. Hooks that one out into right field, but foul. Matthews has hit several home runs this year, looking for another.
Yeah, and he is one of the young bats, a true freshman here in San Antonio who showed a lot of pop, that comes into this lineup today after having seen a couple of days off. Inserted into his normal spot when he is playing offensively, right at the top of the order.
That one grounded over to the third baseman. Throw on to first is in time. Ball gets a little dirty, but Alexander Cannata able to pick it at first from the throw of the third baseman, Jacob Tanner. And there's one out away in the bottom of the first as Kai Tinker steps up to the dish.
Yeah, and it looked like Tanner perhaps was playing a little close to the bag. Maybe not quite even with it, but not too far from that point. That one certainly got on him very quickly. Maybe sped him up just a little bit as he was trying to just get the out and get Southwestern a step closer to the dugout. But you're right. Skipped that throw into first base. Ended up being on a kind of long hop. Made it an easier play over there defensively. And ultimately, first guy up is recorded as an out.
Tinker in a 1-1 count against Rutherford. Hooks that one out into right field. Pirates ranging over to try and get it. And the catch will be made. So Tinker out number two in the bottom of the first as the ball was poked into right field. Three Pirates are ranging over, and one of them able to snag the ball as we head to Nicholas Lazara in the three-hole spot.
And you can probably see from that last angle a lot of movement out there in the field. Harris and Oregon both trying to chase that one down from right field and second base, respectively. Those flags out there in center field blowing from left to right field this afternoon. For the lefties that are in the lineup, they'll have an opportunity to get out ahead of something and try and pull it out of the ballpark here in San Antonio. But those balls batted in the air are certainly going to be affected by the weather that they're experiencing.
Lazara takes ball one as the count ticks to 1-2. Lazara 0 for 3 yesterday, trying to do a bit more damage with the bat against Rutherford today. And in the other batter's box, easy enough take for Lazara. The count evens up at 2-2. Two outs on the board. Contact and right off the pole. Probably heard it on your stream. Lazara will get reset for the 2-2 pitch again. That one fouled off. Once again, into the right field netting, a bit above the Pirate dugout. Rutherford trying to put away Lazara. That one misses low, so a full count. As Nick Lazara trying to prevent the Tigers going 1-2-3 in the bottom of the first. Contact into right field. And the catch easy enough for Harris. So Tigers do go 1-2-3 as Rutherford does not allow a base runner in the first frame. We will head to the top of the second on Tiger Network. Welcome back to San Antonio. We're almost underway here in the second inning as Alexander Cannata will step up to the dish. The bearded bat yesterday went 0 for 3, drew a walk, and struck out once. So the senior out of Austin, Texas, will try to raise his batting average here in game two. First pitch from Pfeiffer. In there for strike one. Cannata awaits the 0-1 pitch. That one fouled back. So an 0-2 count quickly for Alexander Cannata.
Pfeiffer has done a nice job here this afternoon, jumping ahead of most of the hitters that he's faced. Continuing to do so right here. Another very competitive pitch in 0-2 count, way ahead. Put something around the zone. Cannata very, very wisely right there, even though it looked like it was a tough job to do, was able to hold off on it.
That one, a little grounder into left field. It'll be a single for the bearded bat, Alexander Cannata. Just putting it right in between Jack Baker and Kai Tinker. Pierce Matthews fields it cleanly, so only a single for Cannata, but it's a leadoff base runner in the top of the second.
And again, well ahead in this at-bat. Looked like Pfeiffer was perhaps trying to change the eye level just a little bit. Went up in the zone with that one.
That one lined into right field, and that will be... I think they doubled him up, yeah. I am not sure what Cannata was thinking there. I think he thought it was going to get down, but McDonald made the catch easily and doubled up Cannata at first because he didn't tag.
Yeah, and it looks like it's just a hit and run right here. Runners off and moving very early on. The job gets done of a ball being put in play, but you're right. Cannata just never looking back to see where that one was, and it was just up in the air a little too significantly. Maddox McDonald out there in right field doing a nice job closing on it quickly, and ultimately Trinity with a little bit of an unorthodox double play turned right there.
As now Lucas Marlowe, swing and a miss. Makes it a 1-2 count for Marlowe. Yeah, unconventional double play as the Pirates' plans go awry. And Luke Pfeiffer with the second hit batter of the day. So Marlowe will head over to first base. Once again, another hit batter with two outs in the inning.
And coming into this inning, that first at-bat, talked about the fact that he's done a decent job today of getting ahead in counts. This one hurts a little bit more for that exact reason. He was ahead 1-2 and didn't have to flirt with a situation where you're going to put a guy on at all right there. And that one just leaking arm side on Pfeiffer a little too significantly, and it gets in to hit the batter. This is really where I think Luke Pfeiffer has struggled more than any other spot this year. It's with runners on the base paths. Things just seem to change a little bit for him. As you see that one down in the dirt, it's the exact same thing that happened in the first inning after the first batter reached, spiked a couple of pitches down and away.
Ben Foyer, the 1-1 count pitch, grounds it foul over to the Tiger dugout. Make it a 1-2 count now.
But talking in a similar way that we did about Joseph Schwana last night, all of these guys are very actively working when they're out there on the mound. And again, Pfeiffer responding and trying to change something that maybe he struggled with this year.
And Foyer will go down looking. So the Pirates strand another base runner. And off the back of an odd double play and a strikeout by Luke Pfeiffer, the Tigers will head to the bottom of the second, looking for their first run of the game. bottom of the second frame here at Trinity University. On Trinity University baseball field, it is Christian Holloway, the cleanup batter for the Tigers, set to lead things off. The senior takes the first pitch inside for ball one. Holloway, 0 for 4 yesterday, swings through that one. 1-1 count for himself. And that one catches the zone, says the home plate umpire. So 1-2 count for Christian Holloway against Rutherford. Ground ball taken in by Foyer. Throw to first in time. Christian Holloway will be the first out of the inning. He heads back to the dugout as Colt Harris will now step up to the dish.
Yeah, and another at-bat, and we've seen him on both sides of this game already that I think is at least partially influenced by the decision-making of the home plate umpire back there behind the catcher at the moment. A couple of pitches down and away from these right-handed hitters that have gone the way of the arms on the mound that I think otherwise we might disagree with here in the booth, and it's certainly been the case for both of these squads already. So I think the one thing you can be happy with is the consistency.
Throw at first is not in time. Good job by Foyer to get there to even snag the ball, but the speed of Colt Harris will beat out the throw, and the Tigers will have a base runner in the bottom of the second.
Yeah, and it looked like this one wasn't the hardest hit ball, and Foyer out there at short ultimately deciding to work all the way around it made it a little bit of a longer route. Might have had a better chance if he had opted to go to the backhand, plant that foot, and throw off the backside, but instead trying to work all the way around it. Colt Harris, the middle infielder for Trinity, who's moved very well on the defensive side of the ball, has the opportunity to beat that one out and ultimately does.
The Tigers have their first base runner for Cal Coney. And they check Harris over at first. Nothing doing there. Coney working with Harris on first. That one is fouled back. So a 1-1 count for Coney. Did not play in game one. Getting the call to start in game two. Pitch misses. There's a 2-1 count. And Rutherford really staring down Harris over at first, trying to make sure he doesn't advance.
Yeah, as a lefty, certainly will have a better grasp on the running game, one that has been very active so far this season for Trinity.
That one put out into right center field. It's deep. And the catch will be made by Jake Harris. After a little stumble, Colt Harris will head back to first. But a great catch out in right field by Jake Harris.
Yeah, that ball just kept carrying and carrying off the bat based off the reactions of everyone here in San Antonio. And that first angle from over the pitcher's shoulder, it looked like that one was probably a routine fly out, but it just kept going right into that wind stream that we talked about a little while ago. Had an opportunity to jump out of the ballpark. Colt Harris kept creeping and creeping and creeping out there to second base, ultimately had to scramble back in there safely at first.
That passes the buck on to Jack Peterson. Swing and a miss. So a strike for Jack Peterson. The Tigers still have a base runner in Colt Harris at first. Pitch misses high. Evens up the count at 1-1 to Peterson. Jake Peterson certainly has the power to leave the park. Question is, can he get used to the delivery? And it looks like they're going to get Harris in a pickle. But the throw over to second goes into the outfield. So Harris will head over to third. throw there is over the third baseman. Harris will choose not to run home. So Harris will go from first to third thanks to some poor throws by the Pirates.
And this is one thing about having a lefty on the mound. It makes it easy once you see those guys take off to hopefully get this pickoff move going and catch someone on the base paths. But it is always a very difficult task when you can't create throwing lanes. And right there, based on that replay, it looked like Foyer, who was coming straight to the bag, didn't really create a great opportunity for his man in Alexander Cannata over there at first to make that strong delivery. He put it right where his shortstop was, but right in the way of everything was Colt Harris in the base path.
Peterson takes strike two on the outside. 2-2 count with two outs on the board. Harris at third base. The 2-2 pitch. Swing and a miss. Rutherford feels no pressure from Harris at third. And we are done with two innings here in San Antonio. Still no score. It is 0-0 as we head to the top of the third on the Tiger Network. Pfeiffer puts his hat on, steps back onto the mound as he's set to face Jake Harris, who made a great catch out in right center field on defense. He'll try to do damage with the stick now. He takes ball one low. He's 0-1 today. Grounded out to Kai Tinker at third base in his last at bat. Now one misses low. So a 2-0 count to the leadoff batter for the Pirates. So now it is the second time through for Luke Pfeiffer. That one slipping out of Pfeiffer's hands. Breaking ball goes high. It's a 3-0 count. And threatening to walk the leadoff Pirate. And there's going to be a meeting at the mound as Lazara and Dave Smith will take the ball from Pfeiffer, and that'll be the end of Luke Pfeiffer's day. So new pitcher in for the Tigers will be inheriting a 3-0 count. We will take a break and let them get warmed up. Welcome back to the Tiger Network. The new arm on the mound for the Tigers is Shepard Tyler, the freshman out of Austin, Texas, the 4.26 ERA. Tigers match Southwestern with a sidearm of their own.
Yeah, and see some of his stats on the year. Pretty solid ERA for the true freshman, although it's not in the largest sample size. As you see his first delivery right there, and drops down and puts it into the zone after inheriting that 3-0 count from Luke Pfeiffer. But he's still had his name called quite frequently. It's his sixth appearance of the year. He just hasn't gone too far in any of those outings out of the bullpen.
Full count quickly for Harris. That one just a bit too high. So Harris will ultimately draw the walk, but a good job by Shepard Tyler to really fight back and make it a full count.
And I think that's one of the real luxuries that he provides out of the pen. He's a guy that can come in and pretty sure-handedly deliver quite a few strikes for you, as he does right there. Just probably needed the benefit of one fewer balls in that count he inherited.
Check Harris over at first, but nothing doing over there. Harris doesn't need to slide. But Christian Melillo, 0-for-1 today. He struck out in the first inning. We'll lay down the bunt. Tyler misfields it, kind of stumbles. So everyone will be safe. Runners at first and second for Southwestern, as maybe Shepard Tyler becoming victim to the turf monster.
Yeah, it was a little wet here in San Antonio earlier today. It has turned into a very beautiful one, although there's a little humidity. Not entirely sure how this turf has dried here in San Antonio, or if maybe Shepard Tyler was perhaps getting a little too far in front of himself right here. Was thinking about this throw before he even had the ball in hand. Just trying to go with the bare hand.
Another bunt laid down. A throw to first. Will be in time. It was a close play at first, but James Vaquero does his job. Runners move into scoring position with Harris at third and Melillo at second. All for the cleanup hitter, Jacob Tanner, to take advantage of with one out in the top of the third.
Yeah, but can't blame Coach Bunch right there for the decision-making. Another bunt laid down right after Tyler had been unable to record an out on the first one attempted here in the inning. This one an even more difficult play, but he does a nice job of keeping himself gathered even after the mistake made in the infield. Does find a way to get it out, but now a couple runners in scoring position, and they'll face a little bit of a jam.
A one count for Tanner against Shepard Tyler. I want to put out into right field, but foul. So an 0-2 count. Shepard Tyler looking for a strikeout of the cleanup hitter. He was 0-for-0 today. Drew a walk back in the first. Be a much bigger ask this time around. Don't call the strike on the outside edge. So 1-2 count for Jacob Tanner. Sacrifice fly opportunity on the board for the Pirates. They don't want to strand any more runners than they already have. That one in the other batter's box. Be a 2-2 count.
And Tyler coming into this one, 6 1/3 pitched on the year, 6 strikeouts. He's not a guy that's going to overwhelm any hitters with velocity, given the fact that he drops down with this sidearm delivery.
One sharp foul.
Relies pretty heavily on just inducing some soft contact, but in a situation right here with runners on second and third, can't rely on that as heavily. Would be a huge spot for a strikeout, but simultaneously, that infield is playing in, ready to gun down a runner at home if necessary.
Misses the zone high. So the count will tick full for Jacob Tanner. A walk here would load the bases. Maxwell Mims on deck for Southwestern. And that one misses. Tried to get Tanner chasing, but he didn't bite. So now bases loaded for Maxwell Mims.
But But a lot of good pitches in that at-bat from Shepard Tyler right there, especially that last one, a breaking ball that misses just down and away from a spot that has been awarded to these pitchers so far today, and ultimately probably not the worst end result. Give a free pass out with first base open. Now a couple more force outs in the infield.
That one a bit high as Maxwell Mims will take ball one. Has to dodge out a little bit. With bases loaded, prime opportunity to score for Southwestern. One swung through. Zora can't get it in the glove, but either way, it is strike one. Shepard Tyler would love to induce a double play ground ball.
Yeah, second time in this series that Mims has come up with the bases loaded. Yesterday, liner out to center field was good enough to bring one run home, but still in a 0-0 ball game, a huge spot where he's certainly capable of doing even more damage right here.
It's a 2-1 count for Mims. He's at the advantage right now in terms of the count. Sharp liner into right field. That one's going to get down. One run will come in to score. Another runner comes. Maxwell Mims is safe at second, as that's a two RBI double for Maxwell Mims. He drives in Jake Harris and Christian Melillo, and Jacob Tanner will end up at third.
And ultimately, Tyler falling behind in this count 2-1. Doesn't want to fall behind any further. Tries to come right there with a little bit of a two-seam fastball that had some movement back over the heart of the plate. Had a little bit of vertical fade as well. This is dropping out of the zone, but Maxwell Mims, too good of a hitter, and takes advantage right there.
That is the end of the day for Shepard Tyler. Gives up those two runs. So a new arm will be slated to come in for Trinity. Southwestern is up 2-0. We will take a short break on the Tiger Network as the Tigers bring out another arm. And right now, Jack Breezy coming in for the Tigers. Enters the game in a tough spot. Runners on second and third. Certainly not the most enviable position for the new pitcher, but he fires strike one to Alexander Cannata.
And Breezy comes into this one. Another appearance here in the relatively early portion of the 2024 season. He had a couple out of the gates where he got knocked around just a little bit, but his most recent outing, he was much more impressive. Trinity has now run down on the base paths.
And that will be an out as they caught Tanner between home and third. I think they were trying a suicide squeeze as he flashed bunt, and it didn't work. Got called for the strike, and then Tanner was just caught between third and home. So an out for the Tigers. That's two in the top of the third now. The suicide squeeze just doesn't come to fruition.
And you have to just wonder if there was a miscommunication and Kanata maybe didn't get the right read, or if that runner, Tanner, over at third didn't have the right signal in either. I think someone had to have been mixed up right there, because certainly Kanata could have probably put forth a better effort in trying to get that bunt down, especially if that runner was coming from third.
Right now, Maxwell Mims made his way over to third amidst all the chaos. And that one gets away from Lazara. Mims will come home. And the flip attempt by Lazara over to Breezy. There's no play at the plate. It is Southwestern 3, Trinity nothing, as Maxwell Mims comes in to score. So Kanata now working with no base runners.
And hard to fault either party right there, as Lazara has been working very hard behind the plate already in the early going. They had Pfeiffer to start, who spiked his fair share of fastballs. Breezy enters this game with a couple runners in scoring position, lets one get away from him very quickly in the early going, and Lazara just unable to get in front of that fastball, produces another run for the Pirates.
So now Trace Organ, 0 for 1 today, was the victim of the odd double play. That one taken for strike one, with Kanata at first base. The 0-1 pitch taken for strike two. That's Breezy now having better luck finding the zone for now. Puts Organ in an 0-2 count. Swing and a miss. That'll be the end of the top of the third. But the opening salvo fired by the Pirates as they score three in the top of the third. We head to the bottom of the third to see if the Tigers can roar back. Almost underway in the bottom of the third. Jack Baker set to lead things off for the Tigers. And the senior out of Sugarland, Texas, takes the first pitch low for ball one, as the Tigers are still trying to really figure out Rutherford. That one popped foul. So a 1-1 count for Baker. Yesterday, 1-for-2. Drew a walk. That one slapped over to Organ. The throw to first is easy enough. And there's one out away in the bottom of the third inning. So now we go to Maddox McDonald in the nine-hole spot.
And a good opportunity here for Trinity to try and turn this lineup over and bring this offense back to the plate for a second time, give them even more opportunity to see Stephen Rutherford, who continues very impressively.
And the throw over to first gets into right field. McDonald will head over to second. He's rounding for third. The throw still hasn't come in. And now it's finally in the infield, but a bunt, which seemingly was foiled by Marlowe, ends up being very successful because the throw to first just misses the first baseman.
And Marlowe with almost too much time right there. We talked about it on the broadcast yesterday because of a similar play that almost befell Southwestern, a bunt that got down and made contact with the hitter, but he was still in the batter's box. Maddox McDonald is the Trinity counterpart who made contact with the bunt earlier this season while it was in the field of play. Very, very nearly did the exact same right there, but gets the benefit of a kinder bounce that time and ultimately finds his way all the way over to third because of it.
It's popped over into right field. The catch is made. And they're going to say it's going to be a ground rule double as that one goes out of our camera view. You can see the Pirates heading over outside the view of the camera. And it looks like it was a ground rule double. So that will drive in McDonald at third, and Pierce Matthews will head over to second.
Yeah, such an awkward play. I think it was Kai Tinker who came up in the top of the, or the bottom of the first inning, I should say. He hit something out to right field as well and was very slow to get out of the batter's box. A similar play right there. Even the guys in the field defensively out there in right, it seemed like Harris had a little bit of a delayed jump as he was trying to get going on that one. I don't know if they're having a hard time reading the baseball off the bat, if they're just automatically assuming that they're getting out of play.
Driven out into left center field, and that one will be down for a hit. Another run will come in to score for the Tigers as Kai Tinker and Pierce Matthews trade places. It is 3-2. The Tigers trying to come back. A nice, strong drive by Kai Tinker.
Yeah, one of his better jobs this season from a power standpoint. Barrels this one up out into the gap in left center field. Very impressive. He gives that one a very strong ride. Talked about him extensively from an offensive perspective last night. He's a guy that has been incredibly impressive at the plate this year in his fifth campaign in San Antonio. And while his numbers from a batting average perspective might not reflect it in entirety, right? He comes into this one only hitting 250. I think what he's done very, very well is swing at the ball more frequently than a lot of his offensive counterparts. Comes into this game 36 at-bats. He's gotten another couple under his belt today, but he's only struck out twice on the year, and it's been almost invaluable to this Trinity offense.
Turns the lineup to Nick Lazara. Kai Tinker in scoring position over on second base. Lazara takes strike one. So for one today, flew out over to Harris in right field back in the first inning. The 0-1 pitch to Lazara. Swing and a miss, so quickly in an 0-2 count. Still one out in the bottom of the third. I think it is important to point out that we see what you see back at home. So when they do hit into that right-hand corner, we are just as in the dark as you are on your stream. We try our best either way. That one misses. So a 1-2 count for Nick Lazara. But Kai Tinker making it undoubtedly that it was a hit. That one jammer foul. Still a 1-2 count.
And Lazara, again, doing what he does maybe the absolute best at the plate, displaying his knowledge and understanding of the strike zone, defensively playing as catcher, and he's made it pay off for him in the batter's box this season.
That one popped foul. goes into the foul netting behind Lazara. So 3-2, the Tigers have scratched across two runs here in the bottom of the third. Trying to match the Pirates right now. A good opportunity to do so. Good take by Lazara. Evens up the count at 2-2.
It's hard to find a guy in this offense that looks as comfortable as he does with two strikes on the board. He's done so again here in this at-bat as he tries to draw Trinity even.
And ever patient, trying to be rewarded for that patience. As a full count for Nick Lazara. Ground ball fielded by Foyer. The throw over to first is in time. So two outs in the bottom of the third, but Lazara does push Tinker over to third.
And a nice job at the end of the day to one, not strike out in this at-bat. After falling behind 0-2, he works it full and then puts a ball in play and does a second thing, and that's getting a job done, moving Tinker ahead an extra 90 feet. Because now it brings all sorts of possibilities into play, including pass ball that could bring him across, very similar to what we saw in the top half of this inning, to give Southwestern their third run of the day.
Holloway swings through that one as the cleanup batter trying to do what a cleanup batter should and drive in the runner in scoring position. A swing and a miss. So 1-2 count for Holloway as he's bit on two breaking balls by Rutherford. Tinker at third. That one easy enough to take as it was in the other batter's box. So a 2-2 count. Two's on the board for Christian Holloway. That one's too high. So now a full count for the cleanup bat. Holloway facing off against Stephen Rutherford. We'll step off, take another moment. Very quickly, both sides ready to face off again. Put out in to left center field. It's going, it is gone. So Christian Holloway goes yard for the Tigers. As the Tigers will take the lead, 4-3. Christian Holloway, cleanup bat, gets the home run.
And what a job by Christian Holloway right here. You're going to see this fastball right over the heart of the plate. He just jumps out in front of this one. Pretty quick out of the box. This one, again, not the greatest angle of it here. Hard to tell how much clearance it had out in left center field. But based on how quickly he was moving around the path, I think it just snuck out over that left field wall. And certainly ran into a fastball, exactly what you want as a hitter in conditions like we have here in San Antonio. And set himself up for success right there after battling back in that count. Falling behind early 1-2, takes a couple of pitches. And then ultimately, a mistake made by Rutherford on the mound. And the Tigers making him pay big time here in the bottom of the third.
2-0 count for Colt Harris. Or 3-0 count for Colt Harris. Has to follow up the act of Christian Holloway. Now a 3-1 count as he takes that one for a strike. So Holloway makes it a 4-3 Tiger lead. Now a full count for Colt Harris as Rutherford has fought his way back into this one. And it will be a walk drawn by Colt Harris as Rutherford can't finish him off. Free pass for the five-hole bat as Cal Coney will try and continue the inning and continue the damage that the Tigers have done here in the bottom of the third frame.
And Rutherford showing a little bit of frustration after losing Harris right there upon receiving the ball back, gave a little bit of a shout, threw that rosin bag down hard behind the pitching mound as well. He's seen three consecutive full counts against Lazara, Holloway, and then right there, Colt Harris. Got the out on the first one, but two results that he certainly doesn't look too happy with at the moment.
Swing and a miss. So the count unfavorable for Coney right now, 0-2. And when poked foul out into right field, Coney trying not to be the end of the momentum the Tigers have gained. As second time through the lineup, they're seeing Rutherford a bit better. That one too high. 1-2 count for the six-hole bat. Colt Harris over at first base. Oh, misses outside, so evens up the count. Two's on the board yet again for Cal Coney this time. Rutherford trying to push this one to the fourth. Check over at first. Harris slides in. He is safe. Though not really competitive play at first base either way. Now, Rutherford takes a glance at the wristband to get his pitch. That one gets away yet again in the other batter's box. A full count for Cal Coney as he's fought his way back into this AB and starts to draw another walk.
I think with this arm slot of Rutherford, he has the advantage of throwing down in the zone more often than not. These Trinity hitters, as you mentioned, doing a nice job of adjusting.
And the appeal, no swing. So Cal Coney able to check the swing successfully. And a Tiger in scoring position again as he's able to push Colt Harris to second with that walk.
See this appeal right here. That bat barrel whipping around rather quickly. There's some frustration from Southwestern and Rutherford. I think he was headed off the field trying to get back into his own dugout, trying to sell it. The field umpire did not give the appeal, and he had certainly some strong feelings about it as he continues to work here in a very labor-intensive bottom of the third.
Pitch count nearly at 70 for Rutherford. 1-0 count for Jack Peterson. Slapped into right field, but foul. Fortunate for the Pirates, as if that one was fair, that would have likely brought in another run. But instead, everyone will reset. Peterson will try and do something similar. It's a 1-1 count for him. Harris at second, Coney on first. Takes that one, 4-2. As Lucas Marlowe behind the plate has certainly been getting a workout. He's done a good job keeping it in front of him for the most part. Swing and a miss. So once again, two's on the board, but this time for Jack Peterson. Trying to drive in run number five potentially. That one is too high, and once again, a full count for a Tiger. Trying to draw another walk. This one would load the bases. They are making Rutherford work for this one. That one misses. three consecutive full counts, three consecutive walks, and just more frustration building for the Pirates side. As now Rutherford talking with Trace Organ.
Yeah, not as much to complain about on that one. I think some of the qualms that Rutherford has had in this half inning have certainly been warranted. No call coming on the check swing by Coney that makes his way over to second base. But surprised that there hasn't been a more lengthy discussion on the mound. No coaches coming out to talk to him. Just Trace Organ right there, as it's now a very large spot here in the bottom of the third inning. Baker stepping to the plate and bases loaded.
And quickly up 2-0 in the count. Head coach for the Pirates, J.C. Bunch. Trying to leave Rutherford out there for now. But the 3-0 count now. A walk is going to drive in a run. And Baker in the much more favorable position right now. Takes that one for strike one. Not sure Baker would have swung at anything, as they're waiting for Rutherford to throw them a strike. That one misses. So a run will come in to score. RBI for Jack Baker, as Colt Harris will walk on over to home plate and back to the dugout. It is 5-3, Trinity leading. Now Maddox McDonald will be set to continue the conga line for the Tigers.
Yeah, Reed, you said just a moment ago, quickly ahead in that count was Jack Baker. It was 2-0 right off the bat. As Rutherford was just getting back on the mound. It looks like he's still just trying to establish a rhythm here in the bottom of the third. Good job now getting ahead of Maddox McDonald, but by the time he got a strike across to Jack Baker, he was so far behind. It was a really tall task to fully climb that mountain, overcome the hole he had put himself in.
So a 1-1 count for Maddox McDonald. Reached on the error by Marlowe last time with this bunt attempt. Sends that one out into the outfield. And the catch is going to be made. And that will be the end of the bottom of the third, mercifully, for the Pirates. The Pirates score three. The Tigers are spawned by scoring five. We head to the fourth inning. It is 5-3, Tigers leading here in San Antonio. First pitch misses for Lucas Marlowe. 1-0 count for him. Takes strike one. It's a 1-1 count for Marlowe. Looking for hit number one on the year. He was hit by the pitch back in the second. Swing and a miss. A foul tip into the glove, so quickly down 1-2 to Jack Breezy. Doesn't bite at that pitch. Evens up the count at 2-2. As Breezy now working with a lead. Tigers up by two runs. And a ground ball goes foul down the third baseline.
Yeah, didn't have so long to talk about Jack Breezy as he came into the game in the top of the third.
Swing and a miss. Jack Breezy retires Lucas Marlowe as Ben Foyer comes up to bat.
But we'll have the opportunity to do so now after he gets the strikeout to start the fourth and hopefully hang a blank number on the scoreboard here in San Antonio as the Trinity offense finally has awakened here this weekend. But he started his year against Babson College, only recorded one out in that game, gave up five hits, six earned runs, walked a batter. His next outing, got a start against Mary Hardin Baylor. 3 1/3 in that one. A little bit more distance.
Ground ball taken in. The throw to first in time as Kai Tinker fields it cleanly. And the throw is good to Christian Holloway. So two outs in the top of the fourth as Breezy working very quick.
And in that game against Mary Hardin Baylor, had a little bit more distance, but still seven hits allowed, five runs, four of those earned. It's really been in his appearances out of the pen in the last two times out against UT Dallas last weekend and then against East Texas Baptist in a midweek contest where he's been very good. And I think he's especially good when he isn't pitted against facing an opposition lineup multiple times in the same game. Felt like that game against Mary Hardin Baylor here in San Antonio, he really got in trouble that second, third time through the Crusaders lineup when they had an opportunity to just see his breaking ball over and over again.
That one misses. So for Jake Harris, trying to prevent the Pirates going three up, three down. Slices that one foul. So a 2-2 count with two outs on the board for Harris during the top of the fourth. That one misses. So full count for Jake Harris. Still under slight threats of rain, supposedly, depending on which weather radar you look at. And that one looks like it is going foul. That one will bounce into the Tiger dugout, but bounce in foul territory, so no ground rule double for Harris. We'll have to reset the play. So traces the plate, is ready for the next pitch from Breezy. That one put out into right field, and that one will get down for extra bases. It'll be a double for Harris. So, Tigers still up 5-3, but threatening to score are the Pirates as Harris reaches second base. Breezy will now face Christian Melillo.
And this one catching just too much of the plate right there. Breezy recognizing with two outs on the board, he could attack the hitter. Just not the result you want to see. Ultimately, that one barreled up pretty significantly and put out in the right center field gap. Very quickly, it was a quiet top of the fourth. Now Southwestern, an opportunity with a runner in scoring position.
Christian Melillo down in an 0-1 count. Takes that one low for ball one. Evens it up. Spins the bat once. Breezy with the next delivery. Bit too low. So a 2-1 count for Melillo. Harris over at second base. Pirates trying to respond in the top of the fourth. And that one will get into right field down the line. A run is going to come in to score. Melillo heading over to second. There will be no play. An RBI double for Christian Melillo as he drives in Jake Harris. Just puts it in the perfect spot down the line.
And couldn't exactly tell the trajectory of this one off the bat. Didn't look like it was a line drive over the head of Christian Holloway over there at first. Perhaps instead one that bounces up over the top of the Tiger first baseman. But you're right, just a very well-struck ball and perfectly placed as it's able to get over the head of the first baseman and really no opportunity for Trinity to challenge at the plate defensively right there.
And Lazara throws over to second. No play over there. but just checking Melillo back. But Breezy versus James Vaquero now. It's a 1-0 count. The 1-0 pitch from Breezy. Misses, and that's ball two. Two outs in the top of the fourth. Pirates trying to keep the two-out rally going. That one put out into right field, and it will get down. So another run will come in to score. The Pirates have tied it up 5-5 as James Vaquero drives in Christian Melillo with an RBI single.
And again, Southwestern just doing a very nice job as part of this two-out rally right here. And Breezy falling behind in this count, and Vaquero anticipating something over the plate right here. That's exactly what he gets and does exactly what he's supposed to with a pitch like that.
Coach Smith heading out to the mound, having a chat with Breezy. Vaquero over on first base. Looks like it is just a chat. So Breezy will try and get out of the fourth. Send it to Pierce Matthews, Kai Tinker, and Lazara, who are due up for the Tigers in the bottom of the frame. But to do so, he will have to get through Jacob Tanner, who's drawn two walks in a row. Take strike one from Breezy as he attacks the zone. Tigers have the force out at second base. That one gets away from Lazara, and the throw to second will not be in time. So Vaquero will head to second base. No more force out there. Runner in scoring position yet again for Southwestern. As Tanner now looks to drive in Vaquero. Takes strike two. So Breezy ahead in the count. 1-2 count. Two outs on the board. Breezy gets the signal. That one put out into the outfield, ranging over. The catch will be made, and that'll be the end of the top of the fourth. But Southwestern responds and ties the game up at 5-5. We head to the bottom of the frame here in San Antonio.
We welcome you back here on Tiger Network in San Antonio, Texas, after Southwestern was able to draw back even at 5 with the Trinity Tigers. Welcome now to the broadcast. Last night's starter, Joseph Shavana. Joseph, welcome back to Tiger Network. You're officially a veteran.
Thanks for having me. I'm glad I get to do this every other weekend.
Yeah, it's been great getting a little bit insight talked about it a lot last night as Pierce Matthews sends that one over to third base. That play is made cleanly. So a good start to the home half of the fourth for the visitors as Tanner makes that put out to get Rutherford going again here in the fourth. But one thing we talked about pretty extensively on the broadcast yesterday, last time you jumped on, we talked pretty extensively about, you know, the free passes that had been handed out. Again, some steady improvement last night. How do you feel about your performance yesterday and kind of especially through the lens of walking batters?
It feels a lot better. I feel like every outing I've had, I've improved on something. I mean, I was looking at the stats the other day. The first two games, I had 6 walks and like 5-6 innings, and now it got down to 2. So I'm back to pounding the strike zone, which I think is honestly the key to giving your team a chance to win. So I'm excited to see, you know, what improvement I'll make the following week.
Absolutely. As Tinker sends that one out into very shallow right field, it looks like it's Trace Organ who's over to record that one. A second out here in the bottom of the fourth. Very quickly, 2 up, 2 down for this Trinity offense. But that's exactly what we talked about on the broadcast yesterday. It feels very much like you're an individual who is always workshopping and always trying to improve specifics of the game. And one thing that you just mentioned, just pounding the strike zone, was clearly something that you did yesterday, but it was a Southwestern offense that was very good at making you work at it even when you were ahead in counts.
Yeah, I mean, they were really disciplined in knowing what to expect 0-2, 1-2, and not, you know, letting me get away with anything too far outside the zone. But I think the key there is I didn't really establish much, you know, like the tunnel pitches. So it definitely made it easier for them to not swing 0-2, 1-2. And I think that's something I need to work on, just being able to play pitches off of each other and, you know, allow it to confuse the hitter.
Yeah, because clearly you have the endurance in your arm, even in this early portion of the year, consecutive outings where you're right around that 120-pitch mark. And I know we joked about it last week on the broadcast. You weren't sure if your warm-ups were even reaching the plate. But certainly you have the endurance as Lazara puts a drive into that baseball right out the cutout out in left field. Looks like that one's going to clear the wall. Lazara earning a trot here in San Antonio. Puts that one over the left field wall and makes this a 6-5 ball game very quickly. How does it make you feel to see your catcher get rewarded with that one?
That's awesome. I mean, he works so hard. I see him always at practice before it starts, hitting balls off the tee. So, I mean, seeing it come into the game and him having success like that, it's awesome.
Just went down to get one right there. Very quick hands from Lazara as he puts that one over the wall and left. He's a guy that feels like is ready to break out truly at any moment.
Yeah, once he gets into a groove, it's pretty hard to pitch to him. I mean, I feel it during scrimmage. Like, one mistake with him, and that ball's getting crushed.
As Holloway crushes another one as well, puts that out to left field, but unfortunately a little bit too close to the defender out there. It's going to be Christian Melillo who makes the catch and records out number 3 here. But, you know, we'll stay right where we're at. Pleasure having you here. I don't want things to end too quickly. You know, how close of attention do you pay to the offense for this team, right? How close are you monitoring our own hitters when you're out there?
Not too much, to be honest. I feel like I usually just put in my earbuds and I try and watch the game, but everybody's standing near the fence, so I can't really see because I'm sitting down. So I'll catch a few glimpses of what guys are doing, and I'll get up when we score and high five, you know, whoever did something good. But I mean, I kind of just listen to music, jam out, and get ready for the next inning.
Yeah, I imagine you have a general understanding of trends, and of course, Lazara. I think he's one of the more feared bats in this lineup, but it's been a little bit of an interesting year for him. Just his second home run of the season coming right there. A guy that's hitting, I believe now, just a hair under 300. but much like Kai Tinker, who we talked about earlier in the broadcast, two guys that have refused to strike out with all that much frequency. Tinker, just two strikeouts on the year. Lazara with just six. Just hasn't had the ball really bounce his way and finally gets one to go exactly where he wants it.
Yeah, that's the weird thing about baseball. Like, you can have a great hit and just hit it at somebody, and next thing you know it, you're 0 for 3 with three hard hits. And then the next day, you hit a little blooper over short, and now you're 1 for 3, and then you do it again, and then, like, it's so weird. Like, you can get rewarded for doing great, and you can get rewarded for not doing what you want to do. It's definitely an interesting sport, the way that plays out.
We'll get going here in the top of the fifth, and we'll have a opportunity to look at some of the other members of this Trinity staff as Jack Breezy returns. Got hit a little bit in the top of the fourth inning as Southwestern was able to draw even. And Breezy, of course, an interesting arm in this bullpen considering the transition that he's made. Came in, recruited as a catcher, if I'm not mistaken, and now is pretty sure-handed member of this rotation, especially in relief appearances as of late.
Yeah, so he came in as a two-way, mostly catching, but, you know, he had an arm injury, so he was kind of just helping out in the pen, catching, because he couldn't really throw. And then, you know, all of a sudden, I'm like, man, this guy can pitch. Like, I tossed with him a couple times, and his stuff is, it's good. It's electric when it's on. And I mean, he's a great guy.
As he gets the strikeout right there, nice movement on that really tight breaking ball and gets Maxwell Mims to swing at that one just outside of the zone. 3-2 count, pitching with a lot of confidence right there. So now stepping into the box, it'll be Alexander Cannata. 1-for-1 on his day. He walked his last time up in the third inning, trying to get something going for the Pirates as they try and scratch another run and draw even yet again. Breezy operating very quickly on the mound at the moment. And it's another Saturday game, another opportunity, realistically, for Coach Smith to try and piece together a bullpen performance. There have been some unfortunate circumstances with the staff this year, some unforeseen injuries that, you know, plagued things before y'all even really got into the full swing of it. How do you feel these arms have responded, and how do you feel the pin has come together as a whole to scratch and create performances like this?
I mean, I think it makes an opportunity for people to go out there and, you know, showcase what they do as long as they stay within themselves. I mean, you know, I feel like, I mean, Tier getting hurt, he's been a key part of our staff, obviously. And I think as long as our bullpen doesn't think that they have to go out there and be Jackson Tier, as long as they stay within themselves and do what they're capable of doing, I'm pretty confident that our bullpen all the way around could take care of, you know, the injury and work our way through a game. So I think it's a great opportunity for guys to keep learning what they can do and gaining experience.
Yeah, I mean, it's so interesting considering just the roles that Coach Smith uses everyone in. We see Breezy coming in a conference series out of the pen in relief. Talked about it already on the broadcast. Started a midweek game against a pretty significant region opponent in Mary Harden Baylor. Even you yourself have gone back and forth, have seen your role change pretty substantially. But it's been business per usual for all the arms. They've seemingly all been prepared in whatever capacity their name has been called.
Yeah, I think it's just everybody's been pretty good on buying into what we're trying to do as a staff, which is just executing pitches over what the result actually is. Because more often than not, if you execute a pitch, I mean, hitting's hard. So if you execute a pitch, that the hitter's not going to do much damage to it. So, like I said, I think this year everyone's done a good job of understanding what we want out of each pitcher.
And that last hit coming off the bat of Trace Organ was able to deposit it in shallow center field. Again, Breezy operating with two outs here in the top of the inning and trying to find that elusive third one to get Trinity back up to the plate offensively. Looks like off a foul ball right there. We'll have a little bit more of a delay. Perhaps give a home plate umpire a moment to gather himself. Looked like he wore that one off the face mask. But, of course, conference play getting underway here in San Antonio this weekend. Talked about on the broadcast yesterday. Some interesting results around the league. Out in Seguin, St. Thomas completed the sweep of Texas Lutheran. Got two wins and a doubleheader on Thursday and then finished the job. Complete three-game sweep yesterday. I think this is the only other series that's actually gotten underway. The weather has been interesting, to say the very least, in South Texas. But some results on the board include, of course, your squad jumping out to a 1-0 record in conference play, and then Texas Lutheran, one of the other favorites in the league, dropping all three of their opening series.
Yeah, I mean, St. Thomas is each year, I mean, I've been here since 2021, and each year they've gotten better and better. And they're going to be one of those teams that they're going to win games, and they're just going to fight their way through it, and I think eventually they'll definitely be one of the favorites at some point soon.
So we'll have a pitching change here in San Antonio. That number 11 coming on to the mound for the Pirates is going to be Anthony France. For the time being, we'll take a break in San Antonio. Joseph, thank you again for coming on to join us here on Tiger Network. Appreciate it as always.
Thank you for having me.
Welcome back to the Tiger Network. Colt Harris set to start things off. Tigers have a 6-5 lead as Anthony France sends strike one to Harris. France will try and keep the deficit at one. Steps off the mound for a moment, as now he is set to face Harris again. Ahead with an 0-1 count. Nearly hits Harris as the ball drives in on him. So now a 1-1 count. Strike two to Colt Harris. So Harris behind ever so slightly in a 1-2 count. Fighting against France. And that'll be a hit surrendered by France as Harris gets the single to start the bottom of the fifth.
And France coming into this game trying to hold things exactly where they are for Southwestern. Makes a pretty solid delivery on a breaking ball that's already started away, continuing to hook out of the zone. But Harris just doing a better job as a hitter, finding a way to extend his hands, put barrel on the baseball, and he sends that soft liner back through the middle of the infield.
Strike one to Cal Coney. Flew out over to right field in the second, drew a walk in the third. Now works with Colt Harris at first base. Takes a ball as Harris has been on the base paths quite a bit today. Hasn't gone a plate appearance without getting on base somehow. The 1-1 pitch. Strike two. So a similar situation for Calcone as Colt Harris had. The 1-2 count against Anthony France. That one runs in on Coney, so the count evens up at 2-2. As France will attempt not to lose Calcone. Tries to dot the corner, but it misses. Full count for Calcone as France trying not to give another free pass. And the other batter's box. So the runners will all advance. Harris will head to second. Calcone on first. A similar situation for Jack Peterson. Last time he was in this situation, he drew a walk back in the third. So now for one day. His only at bat was a strikeout. He struck out swinging.
France going to continue to try and keep things exactly where they are as Peterson will put this bunt down the third base line. Ultimately, he's going to be thrown out there at first base. Instead, no, he'll be called safe on a very, very close play. It's a nice job of getting this one down. It looks like Tanner was going to have plenty of time, but at full speed, Peterson proving to be a very, very tough out. Continues right there. France coming into this one with some pretty solid numbers. Three appearances, 4.15 ERA on the season, but Trinity trying to spoil those things at the moment.
The bases are juiced for Jack Baker. 1-0 count for him against France. Drives that one out into left center field. It is way back. Jumps at the wall, and the catch is made. The runners have to retreat. They will tag in a run, 7-5, but an incredible leaping grab out in left field by Christian Melillo. That ball just kept going further back, and you can see the leap at the wall. What could have been a very dangerous hit will instead only be a tagged in run.
That one just kept going and going and going, and I thought it was going to be gone, but then Melillo pulled it back. I think Jack Baker was, in his own right, experiencing some stunned disbelief. He took a long track around first base and just continued to kind of jog it out to second even after that one was hauled in. A tough one to swallow, as that one could have broken things wide open here in San Antonio.
Max Milligan fouls the first pitch he sees off. As Max Milligan coming in for Maddox McDonald. So, player with the initials MM replacing the other player with the initials MM. That one count for Milligan. One misses low. So, now a 1-1 count for the Beekeeper. Came in to replace Ty Preston in game one in the middle of that game. That one over to first base. Easy enough tag for Kanata. Just put his body in front of it, kept the ball in front of himself. And got the easy out at first, but runners both in scoring position now as that will advance both of them.
A nice job of just knocking this one down, ensuring that it stays in the infield, because if he doesn't put any body on this one, I think that's another one getting into that right field corner that could prove very difficult and costly for Southwestern. Instead, no damage done right there. Runners advance 90 feet apiece. but now just one out needed to get back into the dugout.
First pitch taken inside for ball one. It is Caleb Woodward who was pinch hitting for Pierce Matthews. Was a leadoff man in game one for the Tigers. It's now a 1-1 count as he takes strike one.
But Coach Scannell very, very quick to make the adjustments as the right-hander in France replaces the lefty in Rutherford. Trinity offense opting with a couple of left-handed bats, guys that, as you mentioned, were of course in the lineup yesterday. Very offensive-minded approach for Coach Scannell as he likes to have the advantage of these left-handed hitters against right-handed arms.
Count evens up at 2-2 for Caleb Woodward. Two outs in the bottom of the fifth. Rather, it's a 1-2 count. My apologies. No, it is a 2-2 count. Just took a while for our stats page to update. That one is flown into left field. It will be foul. You can see some movement in that Tiger bullpen on that angle. Woodward working with two runners in scoring position. Coney at third, Peterson at second. Ground ball over to first base. And Cannata will take it himself. That'll be the end of the fifth inning. Tigers able to put across another run. It is 7-5, Trinity advantage. The game continues on, top of the sixth inning, and a new arm on the mound for Trinity is number 14, Jonathan Newman. Newman will be set to take on Ben Foyer, but you can see Newman's stats on the year. Really nice ERA through almost nine innings pitched, 1.08. First pitch to Foyer is a ball.
He's another guy that's been used exclusively out of the bullpen for this Trinity squad. He's come in this year and done a very, very nice job throwing a majority strikes as he's able to get the first on the board right there.
That pitch misses low and away. So a 2-1 count for Ben Foyer. 0-2 today. Struck out looking in the second. Grounded out to Kai Tinker at third base. Flashes bunt, but pulls back wisely. The batter's count for Foyer.
We talked about it a little bit in the conclusion of last night's game, what was ultimately a 5-2 affair. Imagine that in this region, you're going to need more run support more frequently than not. We're starting to see that a little bit here in San Antonio, so have to imagine whichever of these two bullpens and relief arms are better here in this one. Obviously going to give their team the advantage as both of these offenses have really awoken here in San Antonio.
Foyer will head over to first base. Strike one is taken by Jake Harris on the outside corner. Foyer. Representing the tying run is Harris. Fouls that one off. The top of the sixth. Offense has certainly been more alive in this one than it was in game one. Both sides looking to do some more work. And it is Jonathan Newman who's tasked to hold down a Southwestern lineup that is hitting fairly well. They're hitting .333 as a team here in game two. And 6-for-18 up till now. The 1-2 pitch. That one put out in to right field, but foul. So Foyer will have to go back to first base, and we will repeat the 1-2 pitch. No outs in the top of the sixth. Newman glancing over at Foyer, now checks. No tag attempt by Holloway. Just wanting to keep Foyer over at first base. That one will go into the gap out in left center. It gets down. So a base hit for Harris. Now two runners on the base paths. As despite the 1-2 count, Newman loses Harris via the base hit.
Yeah, and the 1-2 count, really the thing that emphasis needs to be placed on right there, an opportunity to record the first out of this inning. You can see Lazaro lined up on the outside part of the plate, but Newman leaves this one really right down the middle. Good job from Southwestern, even behind in the count. Is this one can be a little bit of a lengthier delay. Lazara trying to throw through to second base, and he hit the batter in the box. Christian Melillo wearing that one.
Be a 1-0 count for Melillo. An RBI double back in the fourth inning. Shows bunt, pulls back. That is a strike. So a 1-1 count as Melillo trying to make it look like the game plan is to advance the runners. See if he flashes bunt again. And that will be strike two. They check over at second again. It's a good throw from Lazara, but Ben Foyer is safe.
And I was about to say, I've already seen one failed attempt here in San Antonio on what was a safety squeeze that resulted in an out. A catcher in Lazara who is more than content to try and throw behind runners. Perfect equation right there. Just couldn't quite get it into second in time, but a very close play nonetheless. As now you imagine with two strikes on the board, Melillo probably going to have to swing away.
And strike three. Delayed call from the umpire, but does get Melillo looking. So one out in the top of the sixth as the lineup heads to James Vaquero, who will be looking to drive in Foyer and Harris.
Yeah, Melillo certainly quite frustrated with the result of that at bat. Had a very good pitch to try and put into play via the bunt. One that was up in the zone, somehow it just missed his bat entirely. And then coming back in a 1-2 count, Newman missing his spot, leaves something really over the heart of the plate, the middle bottom portion of the zone when he was trying to throw up and change the eye level, but it doesn't hurt him at all.
Vaquero fouls that one off in a hole, 0-2. Tigers could get out of the top of the sixth with a double play.
And it's something that we've seen already a couple times this weekend with Joseph Shivana on the mound, but the rest of this staff, not the most adept at inducing double play balls. Good opportunity here if you can hopefully deliver some sort of breaking ball or off-speed pitch down or on the outside part of the plate. and see what exactly Newman can dial up right here.
The 0-2 pitch. Misses the zone. Tried to get a good location, but it'll be a 1-2 count for Vaquero. As Newman donning his pitches in the upper part of the zone. Goes a little bit lower, but that's going to be a foul ball down the third baseline. So reset the play. Still a 1-2 count. As Newman trying to put away Vaquero. Vaquero had a RBI single back in the fourth. Contributed to those 5 runs scored for the Pirates in this game. Timeout called. There will be a meeting at the mound as Lazara and Coach Smith will have a talk with Newman. With the Pirates having Foyer in scoring position, Harris over at first. Game potentially changes with just one swing of the bat.
And already with a mistake being made here in this inning, well ahead in a count 1-2, base hit that was given up previously. I think more than anything else, this has to be a conversation, putting an emphasis on avoiding that same result. Up big time right here in 1-2 count, still have a couple of pitches that you can waste. Certainly, if you're Jonathan Newman, you've already done a very, very good job of leaving things on the outside part of the zone. The one ball in this count, something that Vaquero had to very, very difficultly lay off of. And he was able to do so, but you're Newman. Just remaining competitive on the outside is important.
Trying to get Vaquero to chase. Doesn't bite. The 2-2 count. Well, they tried to attack the outside. See where Newman goes. That one slashed foul. Still a 2-2 count. The even count pitch from Jonathan Newman. That one is fouled back, so Vaquero just staying alive. Being a pest at the plate for Newman.
That's exactly what you have to do as a hitter. Be a nuisance until you can force that pitcher to make a mistake. So far, neither of these guys folding. If you're Newman, you have to make sure it's not going to be you that buckles first.
That one popped foul. So still staying alive.
For Vaquero, might be time to just try and make an adjustment. He's seen a couple of pitches up in the zone that he's put the bat on and fought off. And certainly will have an opportunity if he can get that foot down just a little bit sooner to shoot something the other direction.
One lifted. Catch will be made. So out number 2 in the top of the 6th. As Vaquero ends up going down easily. Base runners can't advance. And the cleanup hitter Jacob Tanner will be set to try and bring in Foyer instead.
And a good job from Newman battling in that at bat. It was a lengthy one for sure, and now he's up to just 23 pitches already here in the top of the 6th. 2 outs to show for it. I'm sure he will be happy with no runners coming across to this point, and now an opportunity to get back to the dugout.
And that one given right over to Baker. Throw to first in time. A good throw from Jack Baker. Ends the top of the 6th. Ben Foyer and Jake Harris are left on the bases as we head to the bottom of the frame in San Antonio. Welcome back to the Tiger Network. Kai Tinker, set to lead things off in the bottom of the sixth, takes ball one as it runs inside. The senior out of Simi Valley, California, has an RBI double back in the third. That is his one hit in his day. That is one for three so far. So tried to make it a two for four day. Went three for five in game one. Takes strike one there. Still going up against Anthony France. Ground ball. Foyer collects the throw over to first. A little bobble. But we'll get Tinker either way. So the bobble not coming back to bite Foyer, because there's one out in the bottom of the sixth.
And we've seen this turf prove to be an issue here in San Antonio for a lot of teams this season. Almost was the case right there for Foyer. This one, not very hard hit, had to come in and charge it pretty aggressively. Ultimately, I'm trying to meet that baseball. It can create some awkward hops and certainly might have created an awkward transition right there. But Kai Tinker running down the baseline still had just enough time to get that strong throw over to first, and it's exactly what happened.
Pitch called strike on the outside edge. It's a 1-1 count for Nick Lazara. France going against Lazara. That one ripped out into right field. And that one will get over for a ground rule double. So a ground rule double for Lazara out in that awkward corner. Once again, the fences for the bullpens are very short.
And, of course, don't have the angle on it, but have to wonder where exactly this one bounced. Off the bat, pretty low line drive. Might have had an opportunity to have skipped pretty significantly before the wall, but the turf here in San Antonio has been quite bouncy. That one gets a lift up over the top, but a very, very strong piece of hitting from Nick Lazara right there, who continues a very impressive showing this afternoon. Finally, getting some balls to bounce a little bit more in his favor. As we talked about very briefly with Joseph Chavanna on the air, he's done a great job of putting the ball in play this year, just hasn't been rewarded all that frequently.
Ball bounced away from Marlowe. That allows Lazara to head over to third base. So now, with Lazara at third, the other Tiger who has hit a home run today, Christian Holloway. That is his one hit, and it's one for 3 day, is the bomb he hit back in the third. Takes that one for a ball. France threatening to give up a walk to Christian Holloway. Puts that one in there for strike one. Batters count for the dangerous cleanup hitter for the Tigers. That one put near the middle of the zone. So a full count for Holloway. Didn't want to swing on the 3-1 count. That one tipped, so stays alive. Getting set to face against France yet again. France now has the pitch. That one up and in. So a walk drawn by Christian Holloway. I'll put runners at the corner for Colt Harris, who has also made his home on the base paths quite a bit today. So a dangerous batter to come up now. Colt Harris hitting three home runs against ETBU. Now having two singles and a drawn walk for his scorecard today. You see, two for two.
Another guy who certainly could deposit one over the left field fence here in San Antonio. bit surprising today. We talked about it early in the broadcast, wind blowing from left to right field. I think it continues to be the case, but both of the balls that have jumped the yard, both exiting to left field.
Harris takes that first pitch for ball one. They did check Holloway over at first base. He had to slide in. So they don't want to lose that double play opportunity. Poked out into right field, but foul.
And Holloway hasn't gone all that frequently on the base paths this year, just 0 for 1 on the season, but certainly a good opportunity with a runner that they have to be mindful of over there at third to send Holloway, might give him an extra step or two.
Chuck Holloway, the throw gets away. That's going to score a run as Lazara just jaunts his way into home. So it is 8-5 as another pickoff attempt misses Kanata over at first. And Holloway will head to second anyways. So no more double play. Colt Harris working with the 1-1 count. There's going to be a meeting at the mound as Lucas Marlow. The pitching coach will meet, and a new arm will be summoned from the bullpen. Tigers score another run. They're up 8-5. We will see what new swashbuckler the Pirates call here in the bottom of the sixth. Welcome back to the Tiger Network. The new pitcher taking a breath before going to face Colt Harris. It is Andrew Harden. He inherits a 1-1 count and a runner at his back in the form of Christian Holloway.
And decent numbers on the season for Harden. Notably 12 innings pitched, 16 strikeouts, a very solid number, but right next to that, 11 walks issued as well. I have to see exactly what the story is here as he comes into this one in San Antonio trying to limit bleeding as much as possible.
3-1 count for Colt Harris. He has singled twice and drawn a walk. Can he find himself on the base paths again? Falls that one back. That pitch was certainly in the zone. It's a full count for Colt Harris. Did you hear sirens in the background? It's Colt Harris is on fire at the plate today. Fouls that one off. Harden trying to put away Harris for out number two here in the bottom of the sixth. Harden and just gets plunked on the shoulder. Harris will head over to first base. Runners on first and second. Had him in a full count, but just lost the grip of the pitch and hit Harris. Brings us to Cal Coney. 0 for 1 today. He's drawn two walks. One in the third, one in the fifth. He flew out over to right field back in the second in his first AB. Makes it 0 for 1 today. Looping breaking ball in the zone for strike one. Harden takes a glance at Holloway at second. Glancing again. Strike two, dots the corner. So an 0-2 count for Cal Coney. Harden looking to get out number one for himself. That one lifted. And Pirates may have a play on it out in foul territory. Looks like it will be a foul. Coney gets to live to swing another bat.
And having to fight that one off after a nice fastball spotted down and away, making it an 0-2 count. Approach has to change right here for Coney in the batter's box. Tries to go the other way with that one. Ultimately a little too far out of the zone. Couldn't quite barrel it up, but at least just the job of extending this at bat one pitch further.
Pirates take a moment to get back into their defensive positioning. That one runs in a little bit, fouled off again by Coney. So 12 pitches right now to Cal. It's Harden trying to get out of the bottom of the six, send it back to the Pirate bats. Ball one. As Coney's tenaciousness at the plate forcing that mistake.
Nice job from Marlowe behind the plate, who continues to work very hard back there, has had a lot of pitches to block this afternoon, and keeps the runners right where they are.
High for ball two, evens up the count. Like you mentioned earlier, Luke, just fighting pitches off. You'll force the pitcher to make mistakes eventually. Now that evens the count at 2-2 for number 11. Misses low and away. So a full count for Cal Coney. A walk would load the bases.
Yeah, one of two things has to happen. Either they have to attack you a little harder over the heart of the plate, or they're going to lose pitches outside of the zone.
Coney fouls it off. Still a full count.
That one a little bit more in Coney's wheelhouse, but ultimately I think the first pitch that we can say is truly in on his hands. Harden does a nice job right there of just speeding this at bat up a little bit and see what he can throw off of it.
And they're going to call Coney looking. Thought he had drawn the walk, but the inside pitch called strike three. So a big out in the bottom of the sixth. Dots the location. And Coney will head back to the dugout as Jack Peterson now works with the runners on base.
And a very, very good pitch right there. Harden opting for a couple of offerings on the inside portion of the plate. First, the fastball that Coney couldn't quite catch up to, and then goes back to similar location with the breaking ball. Coney certainly not too happy about it. He pitched that bat rather early on, but couldn't exactly tell if it was in an appeal to convince the home plate umpire of ball four.
That one fouled off by Peterson. Evens the count up at 1-1. Colt Harris on first. Christian Holloway at second base. Tigers leading by 3 runs, 8-5, here in the bottom of the sixth. That one lifted. Now Foyer having a play, but instead called off by Tanner. So good communication gets the third out of the bottom of the sixth. We head to the seventh inning. Tigers still leading 8-3 as they put up across another run here in the bottom of the sixth frame. We head to the seventh on the Tiger Network. We are back at the top of the seventh. Maxwell Mims starting things off. He's 1-for-3 today. Had a 2-RBI double. And takes strike one from Jonathan Newman, who is still out there. He's worked one inning so far, looking to work two to keep the Pirates at 5 runs. Goes to a similar location, but that one called ball one. So it's a 1-1 count for Maxwell Mims.
Yeah, near identical spots from Jonathan Newman right there. As this breaking ball turned on by Maxwell Mims, well out ahead of that one, just couldn't quite keep it fair. You can see how quickly he's capable of turning on pitches as he does so with that offering. It's exactly why you want to face him in circumstances like these. No runners on in front of him.
The 1-2 pitch. Once again, trying to get the frame is Lazara. But it is going to be a 2-2 count for Mims. And misses low and away. So a full count for Maxwell Mims.
And really 3 or 4 times Newman trying to hit that spot in that at bat. Might have gotten it with his first delivery. Home plate umpire unwilling to give it a second time.
That one misses high, so Mims is on first base. So he tried to really attack that outside edge against Mims, allowing him to make solid contact. But now they have to deal with Alexander Cannata, 1-for-2 today. Single in the second, walk in the third, grounded out in the fifth. Takes strike one here in the top of the seventh.
And really can't be too unhappy about the leadoff walk. I think Newman had certain spots, did a good job of hitting them. Mims, again, just showing his veteran presence at the plate, laying off a lot of pitches. And unfortunately for Trinity, it represents a leadoff base runner.
Check on Mims 2 times. Of course, Maxwell Mims went up to the Northwoods League. Played summer ball there. That one fouled back. Coach Bunch telling me that he learned quite a bit after facing a lot of good competition up in the Northwoods League. It's made him into the monster of a batter he is right now. That one grounded right to first base. Now the throw to second. Be no play over there as Baker had to jump to snag it out of the air. But Holloway, this time, tagging first base before throwing to second. It's a similar play to what we saw yesterday.
Yeah, almost the exact same play outside of the fact that Holloway does complete the job of tagging first base. Kind of got caught in between yesterday. Looked like he wasn't entirely sure of where he was in relation to the bag and ultimately didn't come away with any out as the back end of the play resulted in him throwing the baseball away. This time, Very, very similar, but Jack Baker able to sky and keep this one in the infield. Ultimately, I think Trinity will be pretty content at this stage in the game, allowing those extra 90 feet in exchange for out number one here in the seventh.
Lesson learned by Holloway. It is a strike two to Trace Oregon. Victim of the one double play that the Tigers have turned today. Of course, the unconventional double play. Struck out in the third. Singled in the fifth. Mims trying to play mind games with Newman. Ball misses. It's a 1-2 count. You can see on your screen where Mims is going back and forth. Trying to get Newman thinking he is going to run. And foul tip. Lazari can't glove it, so it will be a 1-2 count again. Sophomore out of Houston. Trying to drive home Mims. A run that is much needed for the Pirates right now. That one a bit high. So a 2-2 count.
Yeah, losing that one. Just a little too much arm side right there, but no harm done. Oregon, recognizing the spin, forces him to back out of the way just a little bit. So ultimately, just a waste pitch for Newman.
That one's a foul tip in the glove of Lazara. So a strikeout for Jonathan Newman. That is two outs in the top of the seventh. So now the task of driving in Mims will be handed off as a new bat for Southwestern. It is Liam Stonestreet coming in to replace Lucas Marlowe in the eight-hole spot. So replacing the catcher with another catcher. Very sensible decision. It's always the most awkward position to pinch hit for. Swing and a miss. Newman pulls the string on that one.
Yeah, typically requires a couple of changes, but the job a little easier when Stonestreet, who started yesterday's game at the catcher spot, was very impressive defensively and can come right into this game, but will need some offensive production. As you can see, Colt Harris running across your screen, forcing Maxwell Mims back to the base. Still trying to keep him honest right there.
Stonestreet takes strike two. Stonestreet shaking his head at that one. Did not agree with the call.
And it's a spot Newman wanted in the bat against Mims that he failed to get a couple of times. But now, turn it around, Stonestreet will get that one called a strike against him.
Ground ball. The throw over to first. In time, Colt Harris with the handy glove. Retires Stonestreet and the Pirates in the top of the seventh. Get up and stretch. We're heading to the bottom of the seventh in San Antonio. Tigers still up 8-5 as we play Take Me Out to the Ball Game. Liam Stonestreet will complete the battery with Braden Simpson coming into this one in the bottom of the seventh. Set to face off against Jack Baker. Sidearm delivery, too high for ball one.
So now the second lefty sidearm delivery of the game. This Trinity offense is going to have to face off against. Wonder if their stint against the starter in this one, Steven Rutherford, will help him out a little bit and shorten that learning curve against Simpson.
Now one hit, gets down in left field, past the glove of Foyer. As a weak liner will be a base hit for Jack Baker to start things off against Simpson. And over to Max Milligan as he steps into your view and into the box.
But it seems like the short answer is yes. No learning curve for Jack Baker right there, as you could see in the replay. He's just able to sneak it past the shortstop with that line drive. Foyer unable to come away with it.
Milligan showed bunt but had to jump out of the box as the ball came in on him. So ball one for Max Milligan. Shows bunt again. They check over at first. Jack Baker is safe. So bunt shown two times. That one taken for a strike. So still a runner at first base. Bunt attempt is no good. So Milligan will have to move Baker over the old-fashioned way.
Yeah, Milligan having his feet moved around a couple times in that at-bat. One pitch getting in on his hands pretty significantly.
Swing and a miss. Milligan is retired. One out in the bottom of the seventh. So we go back to the top of the lineup with Caleb Woodward. Freshman will get the first look at Simpson. Takes the first pitch for strike one. So Woodward will have to contend with the lefty sidearm. And it looks like they will catch Baker in the pickle. The throw to second is successful this time. So the steal attempt, no good. They read Baker like a book. And that'll be two outs in the bottom of the seventh.
Yeah, and Baker showing that he wanted to go for the majority of this inning once he reached base. I think Simpson recognizing that and very effectively just changing his cadence and rhythm enough that Baker took off just a half step too early, and Simpson was able to make the easy read over to first. This time, Southwestern doing a better job of creating a throwing lane and ultimately taking the out where it's given to him by this Trinity offense.
Ball gets away from Stone Street. It'll be 1-2 pitch for Woodward. That one misses. Ball three. Either way, Woodward trying to get on base, and he will as he gets hit near the elbow area. So another base runner for the Tigers in the form of Caleb Woodward. There's been a couple hit batters this game. We go to Kai Tinker, one for four today, is the senior. Had the double in the third for an RBI. Other than that, it was a fly out to right field, and the first flew out to Trace Organ over at second base and grounded out to Ben Foyer at shortstop. They check on Woodward over at first. See if the Tigers are aggressive enough to attempt to steal with two outs. And that one will catch Tinker, so runners on first and second as Simpson struggling with the command.
Yeah, just a big sweeping pitch that comes all the way across the plate right there and ultimately so far inside that it catches Tinker. And what looked for a moment like it would be an easy opportunity to get out of the seventh unscathed has now turned into a pretty high-pressure situation yet again for this Southwestern bullpen.
Lazara takes strike one. He's trying to keep heating up. Had a home run in the fourth. Doubled in the sixth. Makes it a 2-for-4 day. That one fouled back. Quickly in an 0-2 hole against Simpson.
Yeah, that pitch up in the zone. The sidearm delivery almost gives the appearance that it's rising, and Lazara doing everything he could to catch up to that one just a little too late, and all he could do was foul it back. Again, he's been very, very comfortable at the plate with these two strike counts, and honestly, it's more often than not because he has such patience. Simpson doing a nice job of jumping ahead with that first offering right down the middle that he wasn't going to offer at.
Grounder down the line is foul. Still a 1-2 count. But Lazara, being the good catcher that he is, has a good idea for the zone. The 1-2 pitch from Braden Simpson. And that one put out into the outfield, taken in by Mims. And that'll be the end of the bottom of the seventh as Lazara lines out to the center fielder. We head to the eighth inning. No runs come across in the seventh. It is still 8-5 Tiger advantage here in San Antonio. The eighth inning here in San Antonio. Jonathan Newman still in for another inning's worth of work. Has Ben Foyer. Flashes bunt, puts it down, but foul. Nine-hole hitter, 0-for-2 today. Struck out looking in the second, grounded out in the fifth. Drew a walk in the sixth. But the Foyer has been doused so far for Ben Foyer.
And his hopes of reaching via the bunt single probably also doused at the moment. Element of surprise taken off the table, likely going to have to swing it against Jonathan Newman. And the job gets even harder as Newman gets the call on the outside part of the plate for strike two.
One misses. So a 1-2 count for Ben Foyer. A Germanic last name. Foyer translating to fire in English. One's grounded back. Foul. So 1-2 count for Foyer. With the New Braunfels. Some Germanic ancestry here in this part of Texas. That one put up into right field. See if the Tigers have a play on it. Looks like it will ultimately be a foul ball. So still a 1-2 count on the long foul ball. Foyer still burning in the box. There's a pause for a moment. And it looks like maybe collided with the bullpen fence out there. So taking a moment to catch the breath as one of the Tiger players. Of course, we can't see over there, so I'm not sure who it is. But somebody must have hit the fence, because I did see a trainer going out for just a moment before heading back into the dugout.
Yeah, down just long enough to bring the trainer out to the field, and then everything was good, of course.
That one lifted out into center field. Peterson, waving everyone off, takes it in for the easy out on the can of corn out in center.
Newman continuing to operate very effectively out of the pen. It's been four arms used for the Trinity Tigers this afternoon, and Newman now closing in on the highest total of innings pitched so far today. Trinity got two from Luke Pfeiffer. Shepard Tyler came out of the pen, got an out. Jack Breezy so far has the advantage with 2 2/3 thrown. Newman trying to match that the best he can, but Southwestern, they're now down to their final five outs. They're going to have to make a late push to come back in this game.
We'll see if the single that Jake Harris just got right there will get things started. Just put it right up the middle. Classic grounder up the middle for a single. And it looks like there will be a meeting at the mound. And Newman handing the ball off. He now heads back to the dugout. Round of applause for him. So here in the top of the eighth, Newman gets one out. But the single from Harris will end his day as the Tigers summon a new pitcher from the pitching staff. We will take a break on the Tiger Network. So that Trajan Lee could get himself warmed up. Trajan Lee is all set to go. See the 1-0 record, 3.6 ERA. Starts things off against Christian Melillo and working with the runner at his back. First pitch, low and away for ball one.
And some different identities out of the arms of this Trinity bullpen, but Will Hellings, who came in relief last night of Joseph Chavanna, and Trajan Lee into the game now for the Tigers. Two very similar guys, big, hard-throwing righties. As Trajan Lee gets that fastball over the plate, Melillo, not much he can do with it, skies it out to shallow right field, and now Trinity just one out away from getting out of the top of the eighth.
One, two pitches is all Trajan Lee needs. Caleb Woodward ranged in to catch that fly ball out in right field. Pitch gets away from Lazaro for just a moment, but keeps it in front of him. Harris will be content to stay at first base. James Vaquero, 1-for-2 today. Solid contact out into the gap in right center. It will get down, taken in by Peterson. The throw into the infield. No runs will come across, but runners at the corners for the Pirates with two outs here in the top of the eighth.
Yeah, and Vaquero doing a nice job of recognizing the MO right there, understands that it's going to be a righty coming in, trying to throw that fastball just by these Southwestern hitters, and he was prepared for it right there. Got the foot down early, got the barrel extended out in front, and then put something into the gap. Just a better job, ultimately, by the Southwestern hitter. Maybe the best job by Jack Peterson out in center field, getting over into the gap, cutting that one off, not allowing the Southwestern squad to pull a run closer. And on top of that, limiting Vaquero to just one bag to keep that play and force out alive in the middle of the infield.
Pitch misses low, so a 1-1 count for Jacob Tanner. The cleanup bat comes up with runners at the corners. Harris on third, Vaquero on first. Ground ball in the infield. Throw to first will be in time. So no damage done as the weak grounder by Tanner as it fielded cleanly by Harris. And gets it over to Holloway to end the top of the eighth. We head to the bottom of the eighth frame here on the Tiger Network with Christian Holloway, Colt Harris, and Cal Coney due up. The cleanup bat, Christian Holloway, to start things off in the bottom of the eighth against Braden Simpson. Takes the first pitch for ball one, and the throwback from Stone Street nearly going over Simpson's head has to make a pretty sweet catch. to keep it to himself. That next pitch misses the zone for ball two. So quickly ahead in the count is Christian Holloway. Three-oh count for Holloway. The Tigers lead 8-5. They'd love to tack some insurance runs across. And Holloway thought he had the four-pitch walk through the bat. Was heading over to first, but the umpire calling a strike. So a 3-1 count as he goes back to quickly retrieve the bat. Now with that ball fouled off, it is a full count for Christian Holloway. So Simpson trying to turn the tables and turn the tides of this AB. And fouled back. So the battle continues. There's two balls on the field. Stone Street gives the extra one back to the umpire. So of course, there's no multi-ball rule in baseball. That one jammed out into left center field. Shallow, taken in by Ben Foyer, who makes the tough over-the-shoulder catch. First out in the bottom of the eighth.
Yeah, nice job from Simpson responding in that at-bat. Bouncing back after falling behind 3-0, just attacking Christian Holloway. Going in on the hands right there. Holloway pulling the barrel through as much as he possibly could. Was able to get the hands through, but couldn't quite get the barrel there. And ultimately, Foyer doing a nice job ranging back on a very softly hit blooper.
So the senior Colt Harris. Ground ball over to Foyer. Throw over to first is in time. For the first time today, Colt Harris will not be on the base paths as he heads back to the dugout.
And a quick turnaround here in San Antonio. It looked like Christian Holloway was going to take his base to lead off this inning. Simpson turns around and just a couple of pitches later now has two outs on the board. An opportunity to get Southwestern back in the box. An opportunity to tie this one at 8 in the top of the ninth.
Calcone stands in the way of Simpson. Ground ball, Foyer throws it to first, and it is in time to Kanata. So, three up, three down go the Tigers in the bottom of the eighth. Maxwell Mims, Alexander Kanata, and Trace Oregon do up for the Pirates and potentially their final ABs. Welcome back to San Antonio. And if you see on your screen, 11 runners left on base for Southwestern, 10 for the Tigers. So a lot of runs left on the base path for both sides. But for Southwestern, they're going to to have to put some runs across the plate to keep this one going. It's Maxwell Mims. Takes ball one from Trajan Lee to start the top of the ninth.
But again, likely the guy that you would want up to start a rally here if you're Southwestern. Mims has been dangerous with a bat in his hands all weekend.
Mims sends that one out into center field, and it'll bounce on the turf. So, starts things off with the base hit, and perhaps that is the spark that the Pirates offense needs, as Mims will stay on first base and pass things over to the first baseman. The bearded bat himself, Alexander Cannata. Lee's first pitch to Cannata in the turf. So a 1-0 count. Cannata tells Mims to stay put at first. Senior out of Austin. Takes ball two from Trajan Lee. They check over at first. Nothing doing there.
Still with a three-run cushion. Important to try and come at and challenge these Southwestern hitters, especially with a fastball as good as Lee's.
Ball three to Cannata.
Just a little bit too much run on that one. A good height right there. Cannata seemed content to take it. I think trying to challenge in the top half of the zone, important right now, force these Southwestern hitters to catch up with things.
So now Lee still taking on Cannata with the 3-1 count. Batter's count for the first baseman. That one misses. Low and away. So runners on first and second. It's Mims singles, and Cannata draws the free pass. Looks like Cannata is going to be pinch run for. So making a change on the base paths, wanting a faster runner. Cannata does his job. Trades places with the pinch runner. Get him as soon as we can tell who he is. But Mims will stay on second base. The center fielder has plenty of speed. So there'll be a meeting at the mound as Lazara will talk with Lee. Quick couple of words before going back behind home plate.
Yeah, just a conversation between pitcher and catcher right there. Have to be cognizant that the guy stepping into the batter's box now represents the tying run here in San Antonio. It'll be another change. Pinch hitter into the game. Stevenson for the first time in today's affair. I think all series long.
Grounder gets one at second. The throw to first in time. So a double play turned by the Tigers as Owen Stevenson just gets jammed in on the hands and induces that ground ball for a double play.
And Stevenson, a big 6'3", 6'4", right-handed hitter standing in the box. I think recognized he got something he could turn on, but realized just a little bit too late that that was the case. Ultimately, couldn't get the barrel all the way through and an opportunity to tie the ball game. And instead, just one out standing between the end of this one and ultimately a Trinity victory, and not just this game but the series.
It is Liam Stonestreet who stands in the way as Logan Wilson was the pinch runner for the Pirates that was also sent back to the dugout due to that double play. Mims over at third base. A 3-1 count for the catcher. It's fouled off. So, working against Stonestreet. He's fouled one back. It is a 1-2 count. potential final strike. Gets away. The flip back thanks to the helpful bounce from the backstop. They catch Mims in a rundown. And Mims will be tagged out for the final out of this game. Just an unfortunate bounce for Mims off the backstop. And probably one of the oddest final outs you will see here at this field, as the Tigers will take game two and the series with an 8-5 victory over the Pirates.
Yeah, and we've seen that one here in San Antonio before. We've seen it even games with Southwestern this season, I believe, in that neutral game hosted here at Trinity against DeSales. Southwestern benefited from some similar bounces in that victory. Unfortunately, they see their day come to a close this time around, a tough bounce to ultimately finish the game off on.
So the Tigers win this one 8-5. It'll be Pierce Matthews, Kai Tinker, Nick Lazara, Christian Holloway, and Jack Baker all collecting RBIs today for Trinity. And for the Pirates, it was Christian Melillo, James Vaquero, Maxwell Mims, who had the RBIs for Southwestern. But either way, a series win to start off conference play, as the 12th nationally ranked Trinity University Tigers beat the Southwestern University Pirates 8-5. Thank you for joining us on the Tiger Network. First pitch tomorrow on Sunday is set for 1 o'clock, so be sure to join us then to see if the Tigers can get the sweep for Luke Terry. Everyone in the control room, I am Reed Rosales, signing off.